Recorded Books presents Plagues, Pandemics, and Viruses, From the Plague of Athens to COVID-19, by Heather Quinlan, narrated by Samara Naeymi. The Beginning of the End. Ivy is not a parasite or a virus, yet it behaves like one. In fact, ivy arguably performs better than many microscopic killers. Instead of infecting its host and then dying along with it, ivy kills the host and survives. Tales of people leaving their windows open on summer nights only to find that ivy had crept in by morning is enough to make one invest in herbicides, and yet even the deadliest of chemicals don't always do the trick. Look around, and you'll see the survival of the fittest. Humans, trees, dogs, fish, even guinea pigs that are currently alive are descended from ancestors that survived hundreds, thousands, or sometimes even millions of years of disease, environmental change, warfare, anything that nature could throw at it to thin the herd. We're all survivors, and yet we all still die, sometimes quietly and peacefully, and sometimes violently. This book is about those who died in droves, powerless to diseases of the mind, body, and even spirit. Diseases that are so powerful they can fell the strongest of any species, just as a gentle-looking ivy can bring down a mighty oak. The sheer quantity of these deaths affects not only individuals, but communities, economies, even the arts. Without the Great Plague, Canterbury Tales, The Decameron, not even The Seventh Seal, a film that was released centuries later, would exist. When the Old World first met the New World en masse in the 16th century, they proceeded to destroy it with the help of horses, cows, and chickens, while also believing they were saving the indigenous people from a godless life. AIDS brought the outing of the gay community because they were dying. Suddenly, the manliest of Hollywood actors were forced to confess that they loved their fellow manliest of Hollywood actors. In all these scenarios, death reached into places no one had ever imagined it could. This book will cover plagues, pandemics, and all manner of viruses, bacteria, buboes, vaccines, and diseases that felled entire civilizations. But within are also stories of heroism, of art, of warfare, and of healing, because plagues are more than sickness. They reshape borders, create literature, push us to learn what we can about medicine. Hopefully in time to stop diseases whose potential to destroy is only just being realized. A Preface to the Black Death. Let's start with the reason you might have picked up this book, The Black Death. William Langland wrote in his poem, Piers Plowman, "God is deaf nowadays and will not hear us, and for our guilt he grinds good men to dust." Langland was one of the lucky few who survived the Black Death, though lucky may not be the correct word, because once the Black Death disappeared, what remained was a land in ruins and its people insane with grief and confusion. Where did this plague come from? Why did God allow this to happen? Will it come back again? These are all questions we're still asking today in one form or another. Traditionally, the study of history hasn't focused on disease, partly because it's been too mysterious to write about decisively, and partly because it doesn't fit in with our idea of history being written by humans. Sometimes bacteria or viruses do, in fact, do the writing. A 14th century person's lack of understanding about medicine also meant that they didn't record in detail what happened, and when they did, it wasn't reported particularly well. Frequently, diseases were seen as the result of God's wrath over something, lack of prayer, overall heresy. Even Jews were named as potential causes. Widespread death was also blamed on miasma, which we know today as an oppressive feeling. But back then, it was a synonym for bad air. Therefore, a lot of speculating as to just what went on had to be done centuries later. Despite these roadblocks, the medical community was able to piece together several clues. Today, we largely believe that plague was caused by bacteria and turned into a pandemic through international trade. Nothing spreads disease like trade. Trade is great for the economy and terrible at keeping people alive. In this case, the bacterium Yersinia pestis, also known as Y. pestis, hitched a ride on fleas, which hitched a ride on rats, which hitched a ride on ships that started in the Far East and made their way to the Mediterranean, bearing cloth, spices, and plague. Death was coming, and people could not do anything to stop it. The rest is history. Bacteria and viruses. Let's take a minute and look into what Y. pestis is about. Y. pestis is a bacterium. The flu is a virus. Are bacteria and viruses the same thing? No. Bacteria are to viruses what you are to a potato. Both bacteria and viruses can ruin your day by giving you a cold or explosive diarrhea. But that's where the comparison ends. You and a potato actually have more in common because you're both living organisms with complex cells and are capable of reproduction and metabolism. You even both have eyes, so to speak. A virus is not capable of reproduction and metabolism. In some circles, a virus isn't even considered alive, nor is it dead. It exists, so to speak, in a gray area. Bacteria are cellular creatures that you can easily see under a microscope. They were among the first life forms to appear on Earth. They're mostly made of cytoplasm, that is a clear jelly-like fluid that houses all the biochemical reactions that keep bacteria alive. To prevent the cytoplasm from floating away, bacteria are surrounded by cell membranes, also known as cell walls. Though a bacterium is just a tiny single cell, the weight of all the bacteria in the world is more than that of every living plant and animal. Bacteria live everywhere. In the water, on you, trillions are around you right now. On your furniture, in your bed, on your skin, and even inside you. You have 10 times more bacterial cells inside you than your own cells. Bacteria have a bad reputation, but most are actually good, roughly 80% as a matter of fact. For example, the bacteria that live in your gut create conditions that keep bad bacteria away and aid in digestion. When bacteria grow big enough, they reproduce asexually through a process called binary fission. This means that bacteria copy their DNA and then split into daughter cells, which are exact duplicates of their parent. Note that it's parent, not parents, as only one parent cell is involved, hence the word asexual, a being the Greek prefix for non. Viruses are even simpler. They have the dubious distinction of being the simplest life form on Earth. Scientists don't even know where they came from. For starters, they're smaller than bacteria, much smaller, like you next to the Statue of Liberty. Their average size is 100 nanometers. To put that into context, an inch is 254,000 nanometers, meaning a quarter of a billion viruses can fit into 1 inch. Louis Pasteur called the virus a microbe of infinite smallness. This is why millions of types of viruses exist, but we only know of a few thousand. Bacteria may reproduce on their own, but viruses cannot. They need you, the host. Viruses have no cytoplasm and no chemical processes. A virus is just genetic code, either DNA or RNA, and some proteins packaged inside a shell called a capsid. This genetic code is like HTML for a web page. It is what drives a virus to invade. Viruses are the great invaders, better than Genghis Khan, Attila the Hun, or space invaders. They invaded long before them, have continued to do so long after, and have killed far more people. The outer shell of every virus is designed to attach to a particular host cell's receptors. It could be a cell that's part of your nervous system, which is what the rabies virus attaches to, or a cell that's part of your respiratory system, which is what the COVID-19 virus attaches to. Not all host cell receptors look alike, so therefore not all viruses look alike. A coronavirus is round, while a rabies virus looks like a dumbbell. There are many kinds of viruses, but the most common structures are helical, polyhedral, spherical, and complex. When a virus does find a host cell with the right receptors, the virus will bind to it, enter a cell, link its genetic material to the host cell's genetic material, then use the host cell's own parts to turn it into a virus factory. This usually does not end well for the cell and leaves the host facing a viral infection. Even bacteria aren't safe from viruses. So, say one person is sick with a bacterial infection and another is sick with a viral infection. Both people have been infected or contaminated, but by different pathogens, as viruses and bad bacteria are collectively known. When you determine the type of pathogen, then you will know how to treat it, if treatment is available. Bacterial infections can be fought with antibiotics, medicines that destroy bacteria by wrecking their biochemical processes. The biochemical processes of the patient's cells are different enough from those of bacteria, so they largely won't be hurt by antibiotics. We can't do the same with a viral infection, because, as you'll recall, viruses have no biochemical processes. So antibiotics have nothing to attack. It would be like an army going to battle in an empty field. Antiviral drugs can block a virus from entering your cells, but even antiviral drugs don't work the same way on every type of virus. However, we have another weapon. That weapon is called a vaccine. Vaccines won't cure viral diseases, but they will prevent them. This is why people get flu vaccines before winter comes, to lessen the odds of getting the flu. Bacterial infections can be fought with vaccines as well, but generally speaking, vaccines are used more frequently against viruses, because as a rule of thumb, the simpler the pathogen, the more effective the vaccine, and viruses are very, very simple. Your immune system. You've been under attack every second of your life since the day you were born. Bacteria, viruses, fungi, billions of them, are trying to build a home in your body. However, we've evolved a complex army that includes guards, soldiers, intelligence, everything but the cavalry, to protect you from dying. This military of immunity not only identifies enemies, it destroys them, then keeps tabs on them if they ever come back. While most organisms living in your body, even bacteria, are actually helpful, bacteria and viruses called pathogens want to destroy you. We have two ways of stopping this. Innate immunity, which just goes out and kills all unknown pathogens the same way, regardless of whether or not your body has seen them before. And acquired immunity, which is your immune system, which has learned certain pathogens' strategies to avoid danger. Every animal has an innate immune system, even sponges, but only vertebrates have the acquired kind. The first barriers of your immune system are your skin, which we think of as keeping our organs inside, though its other responsibility is to keep invaders out, and the mucous membranes. Mucous membranes line all the internal surfaces that come into contact with the outside, like your nostrils, mouth, and lungs. Mucous membranes produce mucus, which is a thick fluid that traps microbes and helps get rid of them when you cough or blow your nose. Most of the immune system within your body consists of white blood cells called leukocytes, a word from the Greek leuk, meaning white, and cyte, meaning cell. They can go almost anywhere in the body they want, except places like the brain and the spinal column, which, for obvious reasons, are highly guarded areas. Different types of leukocytes exist. Those that are part of the innate immune system are called phagocytes. Phago is the Greek word for eating. They are cells that ingest microorganisms through what's called phagocytosis. They will chase down invading cells, grab them, and swallow them. The grandest phagocytes are the macrophages, which means big eaters. They don't travel around the body looking to help out, but stand guard by your various organs. They will kill invading microbes and also destroy cells that have gone rogue, like cancer cells. They swallow them whole, then trap them inside a membrane where they get torn apart by enzymes. If that isn't enough destruction, neutrophils are the most abundant of the white blood cells. About 100 billion are made every day in the bone marrow. Neutrophils also move through the bloodstream and can quickly get to where the action is after receiving an SOS signal from cells that line the bloodstream. This is called neurocyte recruitment. Neurocytes are akin to the first responders of the immune system. They will also signal other cells for backup by emitting proteins called cytokines. The neutrophils fight so furiously that they can kill healthy cells in the process. Finally, dendritic cells are a type of phagocyte that, as with mucous membranes, hang out on the parts of your body that come into contact with the environment. They devour pathogens, but their work doesn't end there. Dendritic cells then pass along intelligence about these pathogens to the lymph nodes, thus bridging the gap between innate immunity and acquired immunity. In order to be effective, the acquired immune system has to learn everything it can about every pathogen it comes across, then store that information so it can build defenses against it. This isn't a process that begins over time. At birth, you already started to assemble one tough acquired immune system, taking in both the good bacteria that can help you and also harmful ones that can hurt you. This is especially crucial because as a newborn, you were bombarded with bacteria and pathogens that you hadn't had to worry about in the sterile environment of the womb. The acquired system, therefore, keeps its eyes open for any foreign substance that could be dangerous. Dangerous foreign substances are also known as antigens, a word that means antibody generator. Antigens are proteins produced by intruders that incite an immune response from your body, such as creating antibodies that bind to the antigens, tagging the pathogen as an enemy for the immune system to attack. Your acquired immune system includes a type of blood cell that is different from phagocytes. These are called lymphocytes. Lymphocytes go after specific pathogens they already know about, like tackling a most wanted list. The two major types of lymphocytes are T cells and B cells. T cells lead most of the entire acquired immune system, like a dendritic cell when a macrophage finds a pathogen and destroys it. The macrophage will then keep some of the pathogen's antigens, shred them into pieces, carry them on their surface, and bring them to the T cell. This activates the T cell, causing it to release cytokines, which induce it to make tons of copies of itself. Some of these new T cells will track down infected cells and go on the attack, while others will become helper T cells that sound the alarm to attract more white blood cells and release a chemical that allows other white blood cells to multiply. Now, let's go back and say that something specific has penetrated that first barrier, like a rusty nail in your foot. Bacteria from the nail capitalize on this sudden opportunity and enter the wound. At first, their small numbers help them go unnoticed, but after continuously multiplying, they will reach a population threshold whereby they change their behavior and start damaging the body. The immune system then has to switch into high gear and go on the attack as soon as possible. First, the phagocytes begin to swallow up the intruders. Then, the big eaters, the macrophages, intervene. They guard every border region of the body. Most of the time, they alone can stop an attack because they can eat 100 pathogens in one gulp, as it were. When the macrophages start to wear out, they release proteins that tell other phagocytes where they are and call for backup to come ASAP. Neutrophils leave their patrol in the blood route and move to the battlefield. Neutrophils generate barriers that trap and kill bacteria. They are so deadly that they've evolved to self-destruct in order to stop them from causing too much damage. Dead neutrophils gather together in what we call pus. If this is not enough to stop the invasion, the head of the immune system kicks in. Both the dendritic cells and more macrophages get active. They destroy the enemy and start collecting enemy samples. They rip them to pieces and keep them on their outer layers. It's here that a crucial decision is made. Should they signal for antiviral forces that call for antibody cells, or an army of bacteria killers. In this case, it's the antibacterial forces. They then travel to the closest lymph node, where T cells are waiting to be activated. The dendritic cell, or macrophage, is on its way, looking for a T cell with a setup that can connect to the specific enemy's antigen. When it finally finds one, a chain reaction takes place. The T cell is activated. It quickly duplicates over and over. Some become memory T cells that stay in the lymph node and will bring immunity against this enemy, and some travel to the battlefield to help out. The T cells release cytokines, which activate the B cells to make multiple copies of itself. And these B cells start making antibodies, which are specialized proteins that either bind to the surface of a pathogen or activate macrophages to swallow it. Billions of them flood the blood and saturate the body, heading to where they're needed. Meanwhile, at the site of infection, guard and attack cells fight hard, but they also die in the process. T cells work like drill instructors, ordering them to be more aggressive and to stay alive longer, but without help, they can't overwhelm the bacteria. Now, the second line of defense arrives. Antibodies join the battlefield and disable or kill the intruders. Macrophages are especially good at eating up the bacteria that the antibodies have attached to. Now the balance shifts. In a team effort, the infection is wiped out. At this point, millions of your cells have already died, and the ones that haven't committed suicide, so they don't waste resources. However, some stay behind, such as memory T cells. If this enemy is encountered again in the future, they will be ready for it and probably kill it before you even notice. Not every battle is victorious, unfortunately. It takes time for the body to learn where the invaders are, attack, and build up defenses. If a body is too weak, for example from age, to fight back, a severe infection could be fatal. This is where vaccines come in. Vaccines and antibiotics. As great as memory cells are, acquiring them through an infection is always unpleasant and sometimes dangerous. That's why young children are often sick. They don't yet have enough memory cells. Vaccines work by teaching the immune system to learn the different pathogens before they cause an infection. One way of doing this is injecting dead invaders, pathogens that have already been killed, or even just proteins that belonged to the pathogen. This is called a killed vaccine. Our immune system has no problem handling an enemy that's already dead. The vaccine triggers an immune reaction without actually causing the illness. Sometimes, the potency of the memory cells that come from this type of vaccination diminishes over time, which means that booster shots may be necessary. Every year, as summer comes to an end, pharmacies begin to advertise flu shots for the upcoming flu season. One vaccination for the flu will not give you a lifetime immunity. In fact, the vaccination you get might not even give you immunity for one flu season, but it puts the odds in your favor. The flu virus mutates quickly and unpredictably, so every year, researchers try to find a pattern of flu mutations and develop the vaccine accordingly. What you get is a quote-unquote killed version of what researchers and immunologists believe will be the strain that will come out this year. Killed is in quotes because viruses are neither alive nor dead, but this is the best adjective we have. The same is true for quote-unquote live viruses. The next year, a different flu shot will be given. Live vaccines include invaders that are quite alive, though they are very weak. They're just enough to wake up the immune system and create even more memory cells than a killed vaccine. Booster shots are usually not needed. These include vaccines for measles, mumps, and rubella. Unlike killed vaccines, live vaccines need to be refrigerated and maintained in a lab, so they have a finite lifespan. Killed vaccines are easier to store and use. The first published account of a vaccination which was against smallpox, took place in 1796 by British scientist Edward Jenner. At the time, physicians had been on the right track through a process called variolation. They inoculated patients with an injection of bits of smallpox scabs or pus. The idea was that a milder form of the disease would emerge and then subside, leading to immunity. Similar practices had previously been done in China, the Middle East, and Africa, though those were done through inhalation instead of injection. Dr. Edward Jenner not only developed the vaccine for smallpox, he was also greatly responsible for popularizing the use of vaccines in England and the world. Lady Mary Wortley Montagu, the wife of the British ambassador to Constantinople, had herself been stricken by the disease in 1715, leaving her skin pitted with scars. Later, in the Turkish countryside, she witnessed the practice of variolation and wrote to her friends, "The old woman comes with a nutshell full of the matter of the best sort of smallpox and asks what vein you please to have opened. Whereupon she puts into the vein as much matter as can lie upon the head of her needle. Patients retired to bed for a couple of days with a fever, and, Lady Montagu noted, emerged remarkably fine. They have very rarely above 20 or 30 in their faces, which never mark." She reported that thousands of people safely underwent the operation every year, and that the disease had largely been contained in the region. She added, "You may believe I am well satisfied of the safety of this experiment, since I intend to try it on my dear little son." Her son never got smallpox. Unfortunately, not all patients reacted to the inoculations the same way. Some actually did develop full-blown smallpox and died. However, Jenner noticed that during smallpox outbreaks, milkmaids were not infected. He believed this had to do with their exposure to cowpox, a type of pox that erupted on cow udders. The milkmaid's hands would get cowpox blisters, which were irritating but far less dangerous than smallpox. The blisters eventually went away without leading to agonizing suffering and death. Jenner then hypothesized that an injection of cowpox, a less potent version of smallpox, but still in the same viral family, would render a patient immune to smallpox without risking the patient's life. So, in 1796, Jenner inoculated a young boy named James Phipps, the son of Jenner's gardener. Phipps was Jenner's ideal specimen because he's quoted as wanting a healthy boy about 8 years old for the purpose of inoculation for the cowpox. Jenner scraped pus from a cowpox pustule located on the hand of milkmaid Sarah Nelms and used it to inoculate Phipps with two small cuts on each of his arms. After observing Phipps, Jenner wrote, "On the seventh day, he complained of uneasiness in the armpit, and on the ninth, he became a little chilly, lost his appetite, and had a slight headache. During the whole of this day, he was perceptibly indisposed, and spent the night with some degree of restlessness. But on the day following, he was perfectly well." Later, Jenner injected Phipps with pieces of smallpox material, and no outbreak followed. Phipps was immunized from smallpox and cowpox. After Phipps grew up, got married, and had children, Jenner gave him and his family a free lease on a cottage in southwest England, which became the Edward Jenner Museum between 1968 and 1982. Phipps went to Jenner's funeral in 1823 and died at the age of 65 in 1835. Both Jenner and Phipps are buried at the Church of St. Mary in Berkeley, Gloucestershire, England. An illustration of Sarah Nelms' hand, complete with cowpox pustules, from Jenner's An Inquiry into the Causes and Effects of Varioli Vaccinae, can now be seen at Harvard University Center for the History of Medicine. In 1979, the World Health Organization, or WHO, declared smallpox eradicated and vaccinations essentially ended. This victory was the result of public health efforts, with vaccination at the forefront. Vaccinations are administered as a preventative way to keep diseases, such as measles, mumps, diphtheria, tuberculosis, from attacking, or reduce the effects of ones that have already attacked. They largely fight off viral infections, though some work against bacterial ones. Antibiotics are medicines that either work preventatively or attack bacteria after they've already invaded. Unlike vaccines, the practice of administering antibiotics via moldy bread has been around since the times of ancient Egypt, China, Serbia, Greece, and Rome, where its healing properties, particularly when pressed against infected wounds, may have been due to raw forms of antibiotics produced by the mold. But it wouldn't be until the 20th century that mold would completely revolutionize medicine. Antibiotics target one pathogen, bacteria, the bad kind, like the ones that can cause strep throat, staph infections, and pneumonia. While your immune system will go after them, sometimes they can use a little help, just as with a viral infection. That's where antibiotics come in. They can help tear apart bacterial cell walls or block the protein production that is critical to bacterial survival. In 1928, Scottish scientist Alexander Fleming discovered modern-day penicillin, quite by accident. After working with bacteria called Staphylococci, he left the lab to go on vacation and didn't quite clean up as well as he should have. This is lucky for us, because when Fleming returned, he noticed bits of mold growing on a Staphylococci sample. The mold had killed the bacteria. This is penicillin. Penicillin works by stopping bacteria from renewing while it grows. This weakens the cell wall and causes it to burst, killing the bacteria while leaving the host cells intact. The results were shocking. In less than three decades, life expectancy in the United States shot up by 8 years. It was hailed as a miracle drug during World War II, allowing the Allies to patch up a soldier and have him ready to fight again within weeks. Before penicillin, people died from minor cuts that led to infection. Now, they could survive a war. Its discovery sent researchers on the hunt for more antibiotics that are used today in everything from vaccines to cancer drugs. Resistance is not futile. Unfortunately, a resistance has begun, and more of our antibiotics have become less effective. Penicillin and erythromycin, for example, which used to destroy many bacterial strains, have become less lethal against pathogens because of their overuse, leading some bacteria to develop their own resistance. Diseases that were once under control have now made a comeback thanks to these resistant strains, known as superbugs. Just like any organism, bacteria can undergo random mutations. Most are harmless, but occasionally, one comes along that gives its organism an edge in the survival game. This is part of biologist Charles Darwin's theory of natural selection, which states in part that the principle by which each slight variation of a trait, if useful, is preserved. For bacteria, this means mutations that make them resistant to certain antibiotics give them a huge advantage and are therefore passed along to subsequent generation after generation, making them resistant as well, and so on and so on. Reproduction isn't the only way these resistances are passed on. Some bacteria can release their resistant DNA when they die to be picked up by other bacteria. Others use a method called horizontal gene transfer to share their resistant genes with nearby bacteria. Every year, it's estimated that nearly 500,000 new cases of drug-resistant tuberculosis occur worldwide. In the United States, Atlanta, Georgia's Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, or CDC, estimate that every year, 200,000 people get sick from these superbugs, leading to more than 23,000 deaths. The worry is that other bacteria will join this resistance faster than we can come up with solutions, or worse, that bacteria will become immune, leading to all kinds of untreatable diseases. The WHO has characterized antibiotic resistance as a serious threat that is no longer a prediction for the future. It is happening right now in every region of the world and has the potential to affect anyone of any age in any country. Tuberculosis, or TB, which infects the lungs, is the number one infectious disease in the world, killing more than 1 million people each year. TB is difficult to treat, and some strains need years of daily treatment with multiple drugs. Gonorrhea, a sexually transmitted infection, has, through horizontal gene transfer, developed strains resistant to all but a few antibiotics. E. coli can boot out any antibiotics that have entered its cells. Salmonella causes more illnesses, hospitalizations, and deaths than any other foodborne illness. Through horizontal gene transfer, they too are able to use certain enzymes to break down antibiotics before they even attack. Meanwhile, overuse of antibiotics can also leave patients susceptible to other illnesses, like Clostridium difficile, which can cause colitis, a disease of the colon. Staphylococci, or staph, is a group of bacteria that lives everywhere, on our beds, on our skin, up our noses. They're usually harmless, except for certain strains. These won't go down without an enormous fight that might take you with it. Methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus, or MRSA, is another strain that's benefited from horizontal gene transfer. They've become monstrous, resistant to any number of antibiotics. Its victims are often hospitalized patients whose immune systems are already compromised. Because MRSA can get into the skin through spaces created by invasive medical equipment, like catheters or feeding tubes. Prisoners catch MRSA from being in confined spaces with poor hygiene. Treatment is extremely challenging. It's so deadly that researchers have spent years trying to develop a vaccine, though none have yet been approved. Antivirals are not heard about as much as vaccines or antibiotics, but they're just as vital. They're administered to make viral infections less severe, although many have to be given within a specific time frame after the initial infection in order to be effective. Many antivirals stop viral replication by preventing the release of viral components into a host cell or preventing the viruses from being released from the cell. This is a delicate operation, as the antiviral needs to be able to stop the virus without harming your cells, which now contain them. Early medicine. The question, why me, has been asked about everything from a rogue shopping cart denting a car to a grim health prognosis. It was also asked in the earliest days of humankind, when so much of the world was misunderstood and one's fortune seemed to be in the hands of the fates. Medicine men acted as doctors, seers, even lawyers, pleading the afflicted's case to the gods. And when they weren't arguing for the defense, they were using spells, herbs, and charms to try to heal the sick. Today, for all of our philosophical studies and medical discoveries, we're still asking, why me? Emotions frequently act as the driving force in our decision-making, a through line of the human condition, perhaps a holdover from when we were fleeing saber-toothed tigers. In 1943, archaeologist Graham Clark wrote, "To the peoples of the world generally, I venture to think that Paleolithic man has more meaning than the Greeks." This means that instinct kept us alive, while philosophy just made us ask a lot of hypothetical questions. Incidentally, Clark's father, Charles Clark, survived fighting overseas in World War I, only to die in the 1918 flu epidemic. Paging Dr. Paleo. Though in modern times, women tend to live longer than men, it was the other way around in Paleolithic times, between 3.3 million to 10,000 years ago, due primarily to all the ways a woman could die from childbirth. Hemorrhaging, infection, blood clots, or even a baby too large to be born vaginally, with a torturous labor lasting for days until both mother and child died. If the mother lived, chances are that she'd have to endure the same torture multiple times and not always give birth to a baby that was alive. Even with a longer life expectancy than women, though, men lived for only 25 to 40 years. A midlife crisis back then, if such a thing had existed, would have occurred at the same time as adolescence, So perhaps it's better that such existential terrors did not happen until much later. The ailments faced by those living during Paleolithic times varied from place to place. Note that by now, some populations stayed in Africa, while others moved on to today's Asia, Russia, Europe, and by the end of the Paleolithic era, the Americas. With this migration came new climates, new predators, and new viruses and bacteria that one needed to adapt to or die. Add to that potentially fatal broken bones, rickets due to vitamin deficiency, infections that would be easily treatable today, and it's amazing to think that we lived long enough to have sex and reproduce. The earliest Homo sapiens had certain tools to practice medicine: their hands, knives, and needles made of bone, complete with an eye for thread made of animal sinew. Though we don't know when it began, archaeologists have found evidence of suturing from skeletons that date back to Paleolithic times. These people were also the world's first pharmacists. Herbs were discovered in Shanidar Cave in today's Kurdistan. Meanwhile, all the way in northern Europe, a mushroom known as birch polypore, which induced diarrhea to treat constipation, was found among the remains of a man who had been mummified. These are all tremendous pharmaceutical and therapeutic leaps and connections made when almost nothing in terms of instrumentation was available. Bacteria and viruses were all around but unknown. Yet that didn't matter. It was treating the everyday, like arthritis in a 20-something patient, that was a more pressing matter. But the following will demonstrate how medicine evolved, just as those who were its patients evolved. Hippocrates and the First Physicians. Imhotep, 2667 to 2600 BCE, was, among other professions, a physician in ancient Egypt, who was eventually deified as the god of medicine about 2200 years after he died. He's generally considered the author of what's now known as the Edwin Smith Papyrus. Edwin Smith bought the papyrus from an antiques dealer in 1862. It dates to 1600 BCE, long after Imhotep's time, but it is believed to be a copy of Imhotep's work. The papyrus contains almost 100 anatomical terms and describes 48 types of injuries, along with how to treat them. But the majority of the text deals with surgery, trauma, and insights into gynecology. It also contains 8 spells, which may have been used as a last resort when all else failed. Spells in all, the papyrus shows a level of medical knowledge that went well beyond famed Greek physician Hippocrates, who lived 1,000 years later. It begins with the patient examination, after which treatment was divided into 3 sections: an ailment which I will treat, an ailment which I will contend, or an ailment not to be treated. Ones that were thought treatable, or at least worth a try, included stitching wounds, bandaging, splints for broken bones, poultices, battling an infection with honey, and using raw meat to stop bleeding. Immobilization was the answer for skull and spinal injuries, since the connection had already been made between the brain and conditions like paralysis. Despite this, it's Hippocrates, 460 to 375 BCE, who is widely considered the father of modern medicine. Hippocrates is thought to be the first person who believed that diseases came from nature, not the gods. In his On Sacred Diseases, he wrote, "It is thus with regard to the disease called sacred. It appears to me to be nowise more divine, nor more sacred than other diseases, but has a natural cause from the originates like other affections. Men regard its nature and cause as divine, from ignorance and wonder." The Hippocratic Oath, a promise from a doctor to his patient, is still recited by medical school graduates today, some 2,500 years after it was written, even though it's a much different edition, which omits sections like swearing an oath to Apollo. "I swear by Apollo the physician, and Asclepius, and Hygieia, and Panacea, and all the gods and goddesses as my witnesses, that according to my ability and judgment, I will keep this oath and this covenant to teach them this art, without fee or covenant. I will use those dietary regimens which will benefit my patients, and I will do no harm or injustice to them. I will neither give a deadly drug to anybody who asked for it, nor will I make a suggestion to this effect. Similarly, I will not give a woman an abortive remedy. I will not use the knife. Whatever houses I may visit, I will remain free of sexual relations with both female and male persons. What I may see or hear in the course of treatment, I will keep to myself. If I fulfill this oath and do not violate it, may it be granted to me to enjoy life and art, being honored. If I transgress it and swear falsely, may the opposite of all this be my lot. A codified set of medical laws sounds very forward-thinking, but we can actually reach all the way back in time to the Code of Hammurabi. Hammurabi was the Babylonian ruler at the time, written in Mesopotamia between 1948 and 1905 BCE, almost 1,500 years before Hippocrates. Hammurabi was more of a contemporary of Imhotep, if you consider a 600-plus-year difference to be a contemporary. Here is something similar, if slightly more violent, than the Hippocratic Oath. To wit, if a surgeon performs a major operation on a nobleman and caused the death of this man, they shall cut off his hands. This eye-for-an-eye approach reveals much about the differences in the philosophies of both the times and the societies. Indian medicine also predated the Greeks, culminating in the most famous medical guide of its time, Sushruta Samhita, or Sushruta's Compendium, which covered tooth extractions, prostate removal, cauterization, intestinal obstructions, abscess draining, 12 types of fractures, 6 types of dislocations, and cataract surgery, just to name a few. Although hard to date, estimates range from 1000 to 1 BCE. Its teachings range as far as today's Baghdad, Sicily, and Cambodia. The Chinese Yellow Emperor's Inner Canon, 2698 to 2598 BCE, invented, so to speak, the concept of yin and yang, which we still use today, albeit not always in a medical context. The Chinese of the time believed that all states of being could be classified as yin, which corresponds to darkness, cold, and femininity, while its counterpart, yang, was associated with light, warmth, and masculinity. Determining the root of an illness meant checking for a balance of yin and yang, or rather, an imbalance. In this way, it bears more than a passing resemblance to what would be made so popular by the Greeks centuries later, the idea that a healthy body had a balance of four humors. The Chinese also believed in a life force known as qi, which in a healthy person would spread easily through the system of internal channels. A blockage in one or more of these channels could be treated by acupuncture, where a series of needles is strategically placed just below the skin, opening up these blocked channels and allowing the qi to again flow freely. The Sicilian philosopher Empedocles, circa 500 to 430 BCE, introduced the idea of the four humors, which was further developed by Greek Hippocrates and Roman Galen. Here, total health was achieved by the balance of four liquids within the body, known as humors: black bile, yellow bile, blood, and phlegm. These were intertwined with the four elements that formed the basis of our world: earth, air, fire, and water, as well as their associated qualities of dryness, coldness, warmth, and wetness. Hippocrates, though not always correct, at the very least could take a leap beyond the human body to look for a diagnosis, like what made up our world and how it affected us physically and mentally. Hippocrates may have been the father of Western medicine, but Galen was not far behind. Born in what is today Turkey in around 131 CE, Galen was a staunch proponent of the humoral theory, sorting it even further into particular days that were more likely to rebalance humors, a process called crisis. A patient who has trouble breathing, according to Galen, would be more likely to be healed on uneven days, especially the fifth and the seventh. This theory was continued into the 19th century when esteemed Canadian physician Sir William Osler believed that a similar crisis was rarely likely to occur before the third or after the 12th day of any given month. Given that not many technical breakthroughs in medicine had occurred for centuries, and that this was a theory that seemed more plausible than others, Hippocrates and Galen ruled medical thought until the 20th century, until the invention of antibiotics proved to be a better treatment than bleeding a patient. Galen's, however, was not the only word in ancient Roman medicine, at least not during ancient Roman times. Historian Pliny's Natural History cries humbug at the superstitious character of Roman medicine. It reads, "We read, for instance, in the memoirs of Democritus still extant, that for some diseases the skull of a malefactor is most efficacious. Apollonius again informs us in his writings that the most effectual remedy for toothache is to make incision in the gums with the tooth of a man who has died a violent death. And, according to Miletus, human gall is a cure for cataract. For epilepsy, Artemon has prescribed water drawn from a spring in the night, and drunk from the skull of a man who has been slain, and whose body remains unburnt. From the skull, too, of a man who had been hanged, Antaeus made pills that were to be an antidote to the bite of mad dog. Even more than this, man has resorted to similar remedies for the cure of four-footed beasts even. For ear infections in oxen, for instance, the horns have been perforated and human bones inserted. And when swine have been found to be diseased, fine wheat has been given them, which has lain for a night in the spot where a human being has been slain or burnt. Far from us, far too from our writings, be such prescriptions as these. It will be for us to describe remedies only, and not abominations. Cases, for instance, in which the milk of a nursing woman may have a curative effect. Cases where the human spittle may be useful, or the contact of the human body, and other instances of a similar nature. We do not look upon life as so essentially desirable that it must be prolonged at any cost, be it what it may, and you, who are of that opinion, be assured, whoever you may be, that you will die nonetheless, even though you shall have lived in the midst of obscenities or abominations." Medicine from the Middle East. Before launching into plagues and pandemics, another group worth mentioning for its medical acumen is the Arabs. Before the Spanish Inquisition, European populations benefited greatly from Arab knowledge of how things worked on the inside and how they were influenced by the outside. We owe enormous debts of gratitude to the Arab world. They translated much of the Greek writing that would have otherwise been lost to the ages, and they influenced countless numbers of physicians in the Western world in medicine and chemistry. Plus, our adoption of their numerical system meant the end of cumbersome Roman numerals. Imagine having to multiply DCXX and XXIV to get XIVDCCCLXXX, as opposed to 620 times 24 equaling 14,880. Arab writer Rhazes, known by his contemporaries as the Experienced, borrowed from Hippocrates and Galen, among others, but added his own unique observation of diseases. His Liber de Pestilentia contains the first known description of measles and a brilliant discourse on smallpox, which he was able to distinguish from the former. Like Rhazes, Avicenna was a Muslim physician and also philosopher, who combined the principles of Greco-Arabic medicine into great writings, the most famous being his Kanun, or Canon, which served as the go-to medical textbook for longer than nearly any other work in medical history. He could even be described as the father of forceps. Avicenna wrote, "In some cases, a difficult delivery owing to the size of the child, you must endeavor to extract it. When this fails, forceps are to be applied, and the child is to be extracted by them." Avicenna is considered to be one of the greatest scientists of his day. Also known as Ibn Sina, Abu Ali Sina, and Pur Sina, he wrote hundreds of books, 40 of which concern medicine. Avicenna was so highly prized by Christian writers in the later Middle Ages that he's even mentioned in Geoffrey Chaucer's The Canterbury Tales, though not for his work on diseases, but on poisons. However, all this knowledge could not save the mighty city-state of Athens. The Plague of Athens. A quote from Thucydides. The catastrophe was so overwhelming that men, not knowing what would happen next to them, became indifferent to every rule of religion or law. Thucydides was a historian who wrote a firsthand account of the war between the Athenians and the Spartans in the history of the Peloponnesian War. However, his above quote isn't about the effects of war. It's about the effects of plague, specifically the Plague of Athens. This was a plague so powerful that, coupled with war, demolished Athens to the point where the home of some of the world's greatest writers, scientists, artists, and armies would never again reach its former glory. It was replaced by another city-state, Sparta. Sparta was all about war. It devoted all its resources toward it. The Spartan mentality was formed by war. The cities were rivals, or to put it more realistically, Athenians and Spartans hated each other. War seemed inevitable, and indeed, in 431 BCE, they began fighting each other in what became the Peloponnesian War. At one point, Athens looked like it might actually defeat the mighty Spartan warriors, thanks in large part to its superior navy. This navy included men whom Athens had recruited from outside the city. This sudden increase in manpower also brought with it a change in population living in close quarters, along with poor hygiene, and an Athenian port that is believed to have been the entry point of the plague. This port, Piraeus, which wasn't Athens, was the only way Athenians could get food and supplies. The plague killed an estimated 75,000 to 100,000 people, including Pericles, ruler of Athens, along with his wife and two sons. His death had terrible consequences, for Athenians soon realized that it was only his leadership that had held them together. The Plague of Athens came in two waves. Phase 1, in 429 BCE, killed a reported 33% of the population. Phase 2, between 427 and 426 BCE, killed a reported 26% of the population who had survived Phase 1. In total, it reportedly killed close to 100,000 people just in Athens and the nearby areas. According to Thucydides, it began by report first in that part of Ethiopia that lieth upon Egypt, and thence fell down into Egypt and Africa, and into the greatest part of the territories of the king. It invaded Athens on a sudden, and touched first upon those that dwelt in Piraeus, insomuch as they reported that the Peloponnesians had cast poison into their wells, for springs there were not any in that place. But afterwards it came up into the high city, and then they died a great deal faster. This is where Thucydides' opening quote comes into play. Because the rulers who came after Pericles were incompetent, in addition to the Athenians believing they were under a death sentence, law and order broke down. People spent all their money because they didn't think they'd live long enough to enjoy a savings account, and when they didn't die, they were left broke. The earliest plague doctors and family members who tended to the ill were among the most vulnerable. The dead were heaped on top of each other, left to rot, or shoved into mass graves. Sometimes, those carrying the dead would come across an already burning funeral pyre, dump a new corpse on it, and walk away. Others stole from pre-prepared pyres so as to have enough fuel to cremate their own dead. Those lucky enough to survive the plague developed an immunity and became the main caretakers of those who later fell ill. The sight of the many funeral pyres in Athens caused the Spartans to temporarily withdraw from fear of getting the disease. Homer's Plague. The word plague in the header is used loosely, because as we'll later see, scientists, researchers, historians, and all who have studied the Plague of Athens are not certain if it actually was a plague. They mostly have Thucydides' account to guide them, and while his accounts are descriptive, they can be maddeningly confusing when it comes to describing symptoms. The Greeks were well acquainted with diseases, but not how to differentiate them, since they were not at all acquainted with germs. Angry gods could cause disease, and any epidemic was called a plague. In the Iliad, the epic poem about the Trojan War recited by Homer in around the 8th century B.C.E., years before the plague of Athens, he says, "Apollo, the son of Leto and Zeus, angered by the king, brought an evil plague on the army, so that the men were dying, for the son of Atreus had dishonored Chryses, the priest." Apollo was the god of medicine, though he was also a god who caused plague with his arrows. However, naming epic diseases plagues was not due to a lack of medical knowledge solely on the part of the Greeks. This plague is similar to the Bible's book of Exodus, where God inflicted 10 plagues, or disasters, on Egypt in order to force Pharaoh to free the Israelites from slavery. Apollo did so to force Agamemnon to return Chryses' daughter back to him. Thucydides, Plague Reporter. Unlike other diseases of antiquity, or even from a few hundred years ago, the plague of Athens had Thucydides' firsthand account, which he wrote to teach others how to identify the pestilence should it reoccur. The problem was that the symptoms he described could fit a wide variety of diseases. Scholars and physicians alike still debate what exactly caused the plague of Athens. Measles, typhus, smallpox, actual plague? What they had to go on was that the disease came on quickly, initially causing red eyes, a runny nose, and bad breath. Thucydides wrote, "They were taken first with an extreme ache in their heads, redness and inflammation of the eyes, and then inwardly their throats and tongues grew presently bloody, and their breath noisome and unsavory." After that came convulsions, rashes, gangrene, blisters, and the feeling of one's insides being on fire. The final stages were blindness and exhaustion before death. Thucydides reported that most of them had also a strong convulsion, and in some ceased quickly, but in others was long before it gave over. Their bodies outwardly to the touch were neither very hot nor pale, but reddish, livid, and beflowered with little pimples and welks, but so burned inwardly as not to endure any of the lightest clothes or linen garment to be upon them, nor anything but mere nakedness, but rather most willingly to have cast themselves into the cold water. Smallpox was a strong possibility. It's contagious, and its symptoms include fever, rash, and blindness. Yet, Thucydides' description of gangrene on the arms and legs. He wrote, "And he that overcame the worst of it was yet marked with the loss of his extreme parts," is extremely rare for smallpox and may even be a symptom of a secondary illness. Bubonic plague was also a good candidate, but the lack of any description of buboes, painful swellings of the lymph nodes, lessens the odds that the Athenian plague was actually bubonic plague. Scarlet fever? No, it only affects humans. Thucydides wrote that this pestilence sickened dogs, and generally has a very low mortality rate, at least by modern times, although it could have been higher in ancient Greece. Measles was eliminated for the very same reasons and usually only strikes cities with dense populations, above 300,000, few of which existed in the ancient world. The possibility that the Athenian plague was a combination of diseases also existed. Multiple diseases exist simultaneously in any society. It's also possible that the disease that afflicted Athens either went extinct or has mutated in the past several thousand years, along with its various symptoms, so it's simply not recognizable today, especially if one is trying to match the ancient diseases to modern ones in a ratio of 1:1. A 2006 article in Scientific American declared, "Ancient Athenian plague proves to be typhoid." A 2015 article of The Atlantic asked, "Did Ebola cause the ancient plague of Athens?" Even though the Ebola virus didn't appear in humans until 1976 in Africa. Also, according to a 2019 article by Target Health, it is suggested that the outbreak of the plague in Athens in the 5th century B.C.E. was caused by moldy food containing immunosuppressive mycotoxins, including the irritant T2 toxin produced by certain fusarium microfungi. So, when all is said and done, the plague of Athens is still a mystery. Neither doctors nor researchers have uniformly accepted Ebola, typhoid, smallpox, measles, bubonic plague, cholera, influenza, or countless others as its cause. In addition, Thucydides' descriptions of the symptoms have probably lost something in the translation. For example, the ancient Greek word phlugtainai could be blisters or calluses, or could be completely wrong since Thucydides had no medical training. In 1994, the excavation of mass graves dating back to the time of the plague of Athens gave some hope that after 2,500 years, a diagnosis would finally happen. DNA samples from the teeth of the dead pointed to typhoid fever as the primary culprit, but the methods researchers used were soon considered flawed, and because, unlike bacteria, viruses degrade quickly, the possibility of ever discovering what happened in Athens 2,500 years ago is unlikely. As for the Athenians, 5 years of the plague, or whatever affliction it was, dealt a massive blow to Athens, from which it reportedly never recovered. Their wartime strength and morale were in tatters, and they'd also lost a significant amount of their population. Athens would still put up a fight. The Peloponnesian War lasted 17 years, but they were eventually defeated by Sparta, and Athens' glory as the major superpower of ancient Greece was at an end. Once the strongest city-state in Greece before the Peloponnesian War, Athens never regained its hold, and Sparta became Greece's newly crowned superpower. The economic costs of the war cast a shadow all across Greece. Poverty erupted in the Peloponnese region, and war became a common occurrence. Some final words from Thucydides. Besides the present affliction, the reception of the country people and of their substance into the city oppressed both them and much more the people themselves that so came in. For having no houses but dwelling at that time of the year in stifling booths, the mortality was now without all form, and dying men lay tumbling one upon another in the streets, and men half dead about every conduit through desire of water. The temples also, where they dwelt in tents, were all full of the dead that died within them. For oppressed with the violence of the calamity and not knowing what to do, men grew careless, both of holy and profane things alike. And the laws which they formerly used touching funerals were all now broken, everyone burying where he could find room, and many for want of things necessary. After so many deaths before, were forced to become impudent in the funerals of their friends. For when one had made a funeral pile, another getting before him would throw on his dead and give it fire. And when one was in burning, another would come, and having cast there on him whom he carried, go his way again. Thucydides' history of the Peloponnesian War was still unfinished when he died in 399 BCE. It's believed that Xenophon also had a hand in finishing. Xenophon was a Greek soldier and writer who had led 10,000 Greeks safely through the vastness of the Persian Empire after the end of the Peloponnesian War. The Plague of Justinian. An anonymous quote, translation by Ursula Dronke. It sates itself on the lifeblood of fated men, paints red the power's homes with crimson gore, black become the sun's beams in the summers that follow, weathers all treacherous. Do you still seek to know? And what? The Poetic Edda is a series of poems about Norse mythology whose writers are unknown, but their works have had a significant impact on literature, influencing writers like J.R.R. Tolkien and George R.R. Martin. The above selection comes from Völuspá, the Poetic Edda's first section. In it, a fortune teller reveals to Norse god Odin that Odin and many gods will be killed by fire, and Earth will be destroyed by flood during a final battle of good versus evil. This ending is called Ragnarök, Ragna meaning rain and Rök meaning twilight. After Ragnarök, the fortune teller sees the world eventually reappearing from the water, with an eagle soaring over a mountain. The surviving gods reminisce about the past, and the fields begin to grow again. The poetic Edda was written in the 13th century, but it eerily describes an apocalyptic time in the 6th century that took place not only in Scandinavia, but around the world. A global cooling period between 536 and circa 600 CE is believed to have occurred at the same time as a massive volcanic eruption that came from Ilopango in today's El Salvador. Ilopango is now dormant. Researchers led by geologist Robert Dull performed radiocarbon measurements on tree trunks that had been exposed to Ilopango's volcanic deposits. Their results showed that Ilopango spewed the equivalent of 10.5 cubic miles of dense rock. This means that it was one of the biggest volcanic events in the last 7,000 years. The blast was more than 100 times bigger than Washington State's Mount St. Helens eruption in 1980, and several times larger than the Philippines' Mount Pinatubo eruption in 1991. It shot sulfuric gases and particles miles into the sky, reflecting sunlight away from Earth's surface. From the poetic Edda, black become the sun's beams in the summers that follow, kicking off a century-long temperature decline, with global temps down by possibly as much as 3.6 degrees Fahrenheit, and bringing about the end of the classic Maya era. Far away in Europe, Irish records describe crop failures, bread shortages, and famine. Summer snow was reported in southern Italy and China. In Scandinavia, tree growth was severely stunted because of the climactic seesaw, with tree rings bearing telltale signs of damage from frost in the summer of 536. Similar to the language in the Scandinavian poetic Edda, Byzantine historian Procopius wrote in 536 CE that, "During this year, a most dread portent took place, for the sun gave forth its light without brightness, and it seemed exceedingly like the sun in eclipse, for the beams it shed were not clear." The world was beginning to adjust to its new normal when something snapped it back into chaos. It was the plague of Justinian in 541 CE. The plague was named for Emperor Justinian I, who ruled the eastern or Byzantine portion of the Roman Empire at the time, and was best known for directing the construction of the Hagia Sophia, which was originally a Greek Orthodox cathedral and is now a Muslim mosque. Even though an 800-year gap exists between the plague of Justinian and the Black Plague, the commonalities are startling. Both came at a time of failing crops and climactic changes, though in the case of the Black Plague, it was torrentially wet weather, not summer snow. Both plagues are thought to come from the same bacteria, and both are thought to have been ignited by trade that started in the Far East and traveled west, largely via the Silk Road. The Silk Road was a channel of trade routes that began in China and branched out through India and the Middle East, and ended in southern Europe. Another route began in Southeast Asia, branched into East Africa, and ended in southern Europe. These routes lasted in various formations from the 2nd century BCE until roughly 300 years ago. Its name came from the Chinese silk trade, which was so lucrative that the Great Wall of China was extended to protect it. Paper, spices, philosophies, religions, all were traded along this network. Even a tapestry uncovered in Western China showed a Greek warrior and a centaur. Along with cultural and economic trade, both the Silk Road and commercial boats were great for spreading diseases, especially plagues. Both brought along flea-covered rats. It's believed that the cause of the plague of Justinian was the bacteria in these rats that was discussed in the introduction, Yersinia pestis. According to Procopius, who was to the plague of Justinian what Thucydides was to the plague of Athens, "It reached Byzantium in the midst of spring, where I happened to be staying at the time, And it came thusly. At first, those who met these creatures tried to turn them aside by uttering the holiest of names and exorcising them in other ways as best one could. But they accomplished absolutely nothing, for even in sanctuaries, where the most of them fled for refuge, they were dying constantly. But later on, they were unwilling to even listen to their friends when they called them, and they shut themselves up in their rooms and pretended not to hear, although the doors were being beaten down, fearing that he who was calling was one of the spirits. The plague of Justinian was a pandemic that was one of the deadliest ever, unless reports of its death toll were greatly exaggerated. Researchers still debate the overall mortality rate, which could be anywhere from 25 to 50 million people over the 2 centuries it supposedly recurred, starting in 541 CE with recurrences until 750, and caused the end of the Roman Empire and the birth of the Middle Ages. However, this theory does not take into account that the Western Roman Empire was already in disarray, and, by contrast, the Byzantine Empire would survive until 1453, when it was invaded, not by disease, but by the Ottoman Turks. The very fact that it has garnered little attention over the decades and is virtually unknown today, even though it supposedly killed millions upon millions, may prove that it wasn't as deadly as was once thought. Let's start with what we do know. Here's Justinian. Justinian I became emperor in 527 CE, after the Roman Empire had been split in two, a result of the misguided belief that the Roman Empire had grown so large and unwieldy that dividing it into eastern and western halves would make it easier to rule and protect from invaders. Justinian was emperor of what was the Eastern or Byzantine Empire, more Greek-influenced than Roman. This strategy worked terrifically for the eastern half, as they had a robust economy based on agriculture and long-distance trade, but not so much for the western half, who were spending much of their time and money fending off nearby Germanic tribes and government corruption. Justinian wanted to restore the Roman Empire to its glory days, and that meant reuniting the east and west, with himself at the helm. His general, Belisarius, conquered the coastline of North Africa. Then, the kingdom of the Ostrogoths fell, bringing territories like Dalmatia, today's Croatia, Sicily, and even the crown jewel, Rome, back into the fold. Justinian then reclaimed the southern end of the Iberian Peninsula, today's southern Spain, establishing the province of Spania. These campaigns increased Byzantine control over the western Mediterranean, and Justinian's dream seemed to be a sure bet. However, something got in the way of his plans. The plague of Justinian began in China and exploded in Constantinople, the capital of the Byzantine Empire. Previously called Byzantinium, Constantinople is now known as Istanbul, the capital of Turkey. The plague weakened the Byzantine Empire at a critical point when Justinian's armies were claiming victory after victory. With the onslaught of the plague came remedies that included cold water baths and amulets, and physicians were brought in from Alexandria in Egypt. They could not do much, though it probably didn't matter in the long run, as most of the sick who were able to see physicians were only the wealthy sick. Massive taxation had already occurred in order to retake Western Rome, as well as for the building of churches like the Hagia Sophia. Once the plague hit, it cut a wide swath through the farming community and the agricultural trade, which had meant so much to the Byzantines. Fewer people meant fewer farmers, which meant less grain, causing prices to soar and tax revenues to decline. But Justinian wasn't going to let the near collapse of the economic system get in the way of financing his conquests. So in response to his decaying population and territories, Justinian did something unthinkable. He raised taxes and added taxes on the dead, which forced families to pay taxes on behalf of dead loved ones. According to Procopius, when pestilence swept through the whole known world, and notably the Roman Empire, wiping out most of the farming community and, of necessity, leaving a trail of desolation in its wake, Justinian showed no mercy towards the ruined freeholders. Even then, he did not refrain from demanding the annual tax, not only the amount at which he assessed each individual, but also the amount for which his deceased neighbors were liable. The Divine Comedy. In the Divine Comedy, published by Florentine poet Dante Alighieri in 1320, the main character is guided through purgatory and the tortures of hell by ancient Greek poet Virgil. But after the long trek, Dante finally reaches paradise, where he's guided by his great, unrequited love, Beatrice. Justinian I is in heaven, in what's known as Mercury's sphere, hidden by the rays of the sun. This corresponds to Justinian's desire to unite the Roman Empire, but on behalf of his own glory, more than that of Rome's. His introduction was, "Caesar I was, and am Justinian," which means he was Caesar on earth, and Caesar in spirit, but just Justinian in heaven. Yet he's described as a defender of the Christian faith and the restorer of Rome to the empire. Dante treats him as the consummate emperor. Justinian brought back the prestige of the Roman Empire, but that prestige was lost in subsequent years because of divisions in Christianity. For making this loss more regrettable, Dante has Justinian summarize the history of the Roman Empire from his own point of view. Justinian then explains why he is in Mercury's sphere, a place for those who did honorable things in order to gain glory. Now they enjoy paradise, but they are eclipsed by the sun. Justinian died in 565 CE. His obsession with rebuilding the empire led to his legacy as the last Roman. By the end of the century, much of the land in Italy that he had conquered had been lost when the Byzantines changed direction and pushed east into Persia. The initial plague in 541 CE killed close to 40% of Byzantium's inhabitants and led to the deaths of up to one-fourth of the eastern Mediterranean population. Subsequent waves of the plague continued to strike throughout the 6th, 7th, and 8th centuries, though each wave brought fewer fatalities. Competing views claim that the mortality of the Justinian plague was far lower than previously believed. After the last recurrence in 750, pandemics on the scale of the plague of Justinian did not appear again in Europe until close to 600 years later, with the Black Death. Speaking of the Black Death, with the help of samples taken from the teeth of Justinian plague victims in Bavaria, Germany, it was determined that the bacteria called Yersinia pestis most probably caused the plague of Justinian. Since bacteria can sometimes survive in the blood, unlike viruses, hence the inability to diagnose what caused the plague of Athens, teeth were chosen as samples because they have numerous blood vessels. The DNA from Y. pestis was analyzed and found to be closely related, like a cousin, to the strain of Y. pestis that caused the Black Death, a strain that still exists in Central Asia. This suggests that the route of infection was indeed through trade from Asia to Europe. Scientists believe that the Justinian strain eventually died out, just as some family lines die out, based upon DNA analysis of bones found in graves. The type of plague that struck the Byzantine Empire during the reign of Justinian was bubonic, although it was very probable that other types of plague, pneumonic and septicemic, were also present. We're about to find out what this means. The Black Death. If you lived in Europe right before the Black Death, you probably worked on a farm. If you were a man, you were on average 5 feet 7 inches tall, married, and lived in a 2-room house that you built yourself. If you were a woman, you were on average 5 feet 2 inches tall, had been married since you were about 16, and had 3 to 5 children, who would live at least until adolescence. You were also part of the feudal system. Throughout most of medieval Europe, as well as parts of Asia, were the 3 estates. These differed somewhat throughout different times in different countries, but essentially, the 1st estate was clergy, the 2nd estate was nobility, and the 3rd estate comprised most of the population, the peasantry. Taken together, this was called a feudal society. In broad terms, a lord was a landowner and member of the 2nd estate who leased his land to a peasant in the 3rd estate, The peasant and his family were allowed to live on the land, known as a fief, in exchange for working the land or, in some cases, providing military service. This was never something a vassal could work off. They were stuck in this strata for life, and they often paid more taxes than the nobility. The obligations and corresponding rights between lord and vassal concerning the fief formed the basis of the feudal relationship. Aside from being a feudal society, the people of the Middle Ages experienced many of the same problems we do today: overdevelopment, food shortage, and environmental issues. Forests were leveled to make room for the growing populations, and marshes were drained to make room for crops. They didn't have a lot of spare land left, with some parts like England and the Netherlands becoming badly overcrowded. Arable land was being broken into smaller and smaller tracts, so peasants were less able to feed themselves and their families. British economic historian Bruce Campbell estimates that before the Black Death, 40% of people were at the poverty line and 30% were below it. Social inequality is bad for general health. So, with all this famine, filth, and backbreaking work in the world, why bother to go on? Well, this was not the case for every European. Some enjoyed life in cities like Florence, Italy, that were filled with art, public spaces, and temperate climates. But above all, most medieval Europeans had a strong belief in God and the church. Through good works and prayer, a person may not have an easy life on earth, but after death, they would hopefully enjoy an eternity in paradise. People attempted to stack the odds in their favor. They carried holy trinkets, like pieces of the communion wafer or relics, which were usually phony, such as a piece of the true cross, the tooth of a martyred saint. Priests encouraged parishioners to donate as much as they could to the church and hospitals run by the church, whether it be money, land, or anything else they had to offer. Since the belief was that God spoke through the clergy, the more people gave, the better their chances were of an eternity in paradise, even if these were people who had almost nothing to give. Europe of the 1300s didn't start well. Repeated hot and wet summers destroyed the fields that yielded the crops that populations relied on. Famine ensued.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.